Good morning.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It is so good to be with each of you on this chilly Sunday morning. In case you wondered, the heat is on. It's just cold outside. So if you need a little more heat, these vents in the floor are blowing something up that feels like heat to me. So get close to one of those if you need to, or snuggle up with your neighbor. Whatever you're most comfortable with is fine with us. I am so glad that you have joined us today as we continue to seek the God who is already seeking us. A few announcements for you this morning. Southern Comfort Brass Band will be here next Sunday. We cannot wait for them to lead us in worship. Mardi Gras clothing and sparkles are encouraged. We will be having king cake after service. So come and celebrate the season of Mardi Gras with us as we get ready to go into our Lenten season. We'd love to have you next Sunday. And then our Wells Fest Cares concert is Sunday, February the 4th. And that is a Steve Chester tribute concert. So y'all please come out for that and support Wells Fest Cares. It's getting darker later in the day, praise the Lord. So we'll have a little bit more light as we gather together. Come and support that wonderful initiative. We'd love to have you. Bring a friend. It's a great way to come and just fellowship with one another. And then you may have noticed last week that we had a little ice and a little cold, so we decided to hold off on tacos and trivia until this Wednesday. So this Wednesday, we will have tacos and trivia. I did hear it was going to rain, but the rain will not cancel our event. So cover your hair up and come on to tacos and trivia Wednesday night. I don't like to get my hair wet. Please fill this out. Put it in the bulletin. We would love, love, love to have you. It's going to be great fun. Jane Everly has helped put all of our questions together. Some of them are easy. Some of them are quite difficult. And Jim Pollard and I will be hosting together. And Jane will keep score, so y'all can't yell at me. So come to Tacos and Trivia. It really is going to be a ton of fun. And if you would like to volunteer, you can mark that on your registration form as well. Any other announcements that I may have missed? Yes, Charles?
Weather permitting, we will have our food distribution Tuesday morning.
Awesome, thank you.
And my sister's going to bring a whole bunch of Mardi Gras beans
to hand out. Awesome, good, thank you, Rhonda. All right, birthdays. Anna Gibson has a birthday today. Jefferson Parker Sr. and Trissy Kelly have birthdays tomorrow. Kenneth Redding later in the week. Tammy Beatty on the 26th. Happy birthday. Christian Cheryl Jordan on the 27th and Aaron Arujo on the 28th. Are there other birthdays this morning? Wow. Okay, you first.
Kathy Long's birthday is the same day as mine.
Awesome. Yes.
So, yeah, she's slightly younger.
Just a little bit. Natalie Long, awesome, thank you. Carol?
My sweet grandson Christian will be 21 tomorrow.
Wow.
Yeah. My good friend Carolyn Harrison, who goes to one of the other Methodist churches in town, has a birthday Thursday.
Awesome, yes.
Bob Gates would be 74 today.
Yes. Great, lots of birthdays, yes.
One of my best friends on Thursday turned 16.
Wonderful. I don't have any anniversaries on my list. Are there anniversaries that you know of that you would like to lift up today? Yes.
January 28th will be 6 years
after
Calvary.
Wow. Thank you. Thanks be to God. Any anniversaries or birthdays of sobriety we would like to lift up this morning? Well, again, welcome. We are delighted to have you in this space today. Would you stand and join me in our opening hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory? It's on page 577 in your hymnal. Would you remain standing and join me in our call to worship? This is going to be a little different today, so y'all just listen closely. I'm going to give you some instructions. James Mason, will you raise your hand? Luke, will you raise your hand? If you're on this side of Luke, raise your hand again. Thank you. You are group B. If you are on this side of James, you are group A. Okay? Group A. And group B. Are we ready? All right. Are you listening? God is doing a new thing. Will you join in?
Yes, we will follow.
Listen, did you miss it? God calls us again to build the kingdom of heaven. Will you join in?
Yes, we will be builders of the kingdom.
Wait. Did you catch that? Again, God calls us to declare the good news to those in need. Will you join in?
Yes, we will declare the good news with our voices and our lives.
And still, God calls. God never quits calling us to live and to give abundant life. Will you join in?
Yes.
May we respond to God's loving and persistent call with a loving and persistent yes. A yes for us, a yes for our neighbors, and a yes for the world to be transformed by the good news that God's kingdom has come near. Amen. Would you continue standing and join me in our affirmation of faith? It can be found on page 883 in your hymnal. As you feel God's Spirit leading you, would you join me? We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may now share signs of Christ's peace with one another. The Lord be with you. You may be seated.
I have heard my people cry.
Each time that we gather together for worship, we have the joy and the opportunity to celebrate with one another and to pray for one another. I would love to lift up a few celebrations and a few prayer requests this morning, and then I would invite you to lift aloud those things that you are celebrating and those people that you are praying for as well. The first thing I'm celebrating this morning is that Reverend Sheila Cumbest is with us today. Sheila is the pastor at Morton United Methodist and married to our senior pastor, Chris Cumbest. So they have swapped pulpits this morning. So Sheila, we celebrate your being with us. We are so grateful to have you here. And we will pray for Chris this morning and hope he doesn't mess up what you've got going on over there. This morning, we lift up a friend, son of Pam Hines, who was having surgery last week. We continue to pray for Jane Streets, who had surgery last week and is doing better, Loy.
She's doing well.
Good, good, good. And I think I read no lymph node involvement in her surgery as well, so that's wonderful. Great, great news. Brenda Sullivan asked for us to pray for Corey Burks, who had an accident last week. We continue to pray for those who are struggling in the cold weather, those without shelter and a warm place to sleep, those without warm food to fill their stomachs. We lift them. We continue to pray for Helen Wallace and for Bill Baker, for Steve Neff and Stan Long, for Sandra Armstrong, for Kathleen and Galen Reagan, for Dora Boaz and Peyton Irby. We continue to lift up Shay Pollard in our prayers and Reverend Aaron Hicks. We continue to pray for Leonard Blanton and Rich and Jackie McInnes, for Michelle Strader and Thomas McClinton, for Jean Boykin and Ray Lee, for Margie Prine and Elizabeth Harrison, for Gwendolyn McGowan and Rosemary Luckett. Are there other things that you're celebrating today, or those that you would like to lift in prayer? Yes.
You mentioned Helen Wallace. She died this week, so pray for her.
Thank you. Linda? Yes, Debbie? Erin, do you have something up top? Yes. Brenda?
Prayers for the family of Wes Pollock, 32-year-old young man who was killed in a car wreck.
Yes, Rhonda.
Both my boys, Henry and Justin, it's a parenting issue.
Okay. Kevin?
Pray for a co-worker, his family, lost his father last week.
Ashley? Pray for Greg and his rotary team.
Yes, Kim?
Successful surgery for Dave Pierce and associates. He wants to thank everybody for their privilege.
Yes.
Prayer for my father, Todd Brinkley, who just had a tumor removed from his back.
Sheila.
Kara Goff, family, friend of ours.
Sherelle, did you have something? Yes. Would you pray with me? Our gracious and eternal God, we thank you that Jesus' call to his disciples came in such an uneventful way. Contrary to the wisdom of the world, he did not start with the privileged and the wealthy and the powerful. He did not begin with those who had little need and little desire for change. He began with some very simple people. He began with fishermen. We pray that his call, "Come and follow me," might again reverberate through our souls today. May we hear again the challenge to be your disciples. May we hear again the message of this one who brings good news. May we hear again the invitation to come to you, all who are weary and heavy laden. May we hear again those simple words, "Come, follow me." And may we come just as we are and know again the depth of your grace and your love for us. God, give us the power to bring change and transformation to the people of the world, as did those early fishermen. Give us the power to provide the same kind of hope for the world as they brought to theirs. Give us the vision of a world transformed. God, we pray for those whose health is a constant and major concern. Be especially with those who have fear and those with no hope of ever feeling better again. God, would you give peace to those who are afraid? And would you give warmth to those who are freezing? God, would you continue to call each of us to step into those places of darkness, of hopelessness, and of hurt? God, continue to call us to be friends. We pray all these things in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." As we join in a time of offering today, I invite you to give as God's Spirit is leading you. Would you pray with me? God, for the gifts that you've given us, we are so thankful. Would you bless the gifts that are given back to you today? Would you use them as you see fit? In the name of Christ, amen. Would you remain standing as we join together in our Old Testament reading? This comes from the book of Jonah, chapter 3, and we will be reading verses 1 through 5 this morning. Hear these words from the book of Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite you to continue standing and join us as we sing together, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." This song is in the skinny book, "The Faith We Sing," so not our normal hymnal. So we'll be singing out of "The Faith We Sing," number
I'll ask you to remain standing once more as we share the gospel lesson from Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, this morning. Hear these words. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in the boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. The call of God comes in many ways. It surprises us when we actually hear from God, doesn't it? Sometimes. I remember the first time, because I was so young when I said first to God, yes. The second time I really remember God calling me, I was sitting on my bed at MUW, the W, studying for a test. God doesn't usually show up when you're studying for a test. Well, no, maybe he does, because lots of us pray to get through those. But I was so surprised when God said to me, "Go home." I sat there a moment and looked around. I was the only one in the room. But I swore I heard, "Go home." Well, little surprise for my parents. I called South Alabama, transferred, and went home. Literally without them knowing what I'd done. I walked up to the door. I got home after that semester was over. It was in December. Classes had let out, and I went home. But I told my parents, "I've transferred. I'm going to move in with my cousin in Mobile, and I'll be going to USA." And all they said was, "Why?" And the call came, I believe, because God was laying the foundation for something that was going to happen soon. Many of you might have guessed by now. I went home because that's where Chris was. Now, he's going to tell you a different story, and I'm going to tell it a different way in just a minute. Y'all, the man loves to talk. I know you know that. And he loves to tell stories. I'm not a great storyteller. And so today might not be as interesting or fascinating as it usually is. But I'll say this. God has continued to call me again and again. God is always calling us. And it doesn't have to do with full-time Christian ordained ministry. God is calling us all the time. And it takes some practice for us to learn how to listen to God, doesn't it? Haven't you found it really takes effort to sit still long enough to hear God? Sometimes we have to make preparation. That's one of the hard things we have to learn as a Christian, to be disciplined enough to stop and listen for God to speak. Now, we're going to try something this morning. It may make you uncomfortable. I don't often do this, but in my own practice, I love to sit in solitude and quietness. We don't do that a lot in worship. And so sometimes we're not real prepared to listen for God when we get here, because we've had kids to get ready. We've had ourselves to get ready. We've met the person in the neighborhood who dumped our trash, or the dog got into it, or the roads were so slick, it was hard to get here. It's cold. It's raining. It's something. And we're not prepared to listen for what God is going to say to us today. So we're going to practice for a minute. 1 minute. I want you to close your eyes with me and try to let go of all that was happening before you got here. Let's close our eyes. I want us to just listen and acknowledge God's presence is with us. And I want you to think for a moment about the last time you said yes to God. That you knew God was speaking something to you, and you said yes. As we open our eyes, I want us to continue in that spirit to acknowledge that God may be speaking something new to you in this moment. God's presence is with us always. God is always calling, and if we listen, if we deeply listen, even in the midst of all the noise, we can hear God's persistent call on our life. And the reason God persistently calls us is because God loves us. His love is unending, ever seeking you. You know, sometimes we wonder what it takes to be a disciple of Jesus. What did it take for those early disciples? It took saying yes, didn't it? At least first. And how did they come to this immediate response anyway? How do any of us come to a response to God when we say yes? I think a lot of times for us it's that someone has helped us get ready. Someone helped us get ready to listen, to hear God's voice, to let us know that God actually does speak to us and care for us. As I ask you to think about your last yes to God, we might see that as a step in growth, a step in discipleship, a step of faith. How do we succeed? I mean, how do we heed God's call? I believe it's by listening, deeply listening, and earnestly wanting to participate faithfully in what God is doing in this world and in our lives, what God wants for us. Can we admit that we really want that too? Do we really want deeply, earnestly, to be faithful to God and participate in what God's doing in the world? That's the call on our lives as disciples of Christ. Well, how do we continue to do that? What inspires you as an individual or as a community of faith to continue listening for God's call in your life? What inspires you to do that? As I thought about what inspired me, I thought, it's when I have that quiet time and I acknowledge God is with me. God cares about me. God is listening to me as well. It's when I see change happen in people's lives, and it's maybe dramatic or it's simple. It's letting go of something they couldn't let go of or picking up something they never thought they could. It's embracing someone they never thought they could forgive. It's giving a new direction. It's finding hope when people were just hopeless. That's what inspires me to keep listening for God and to keep seeking God and for me to keep following God. How do we participate in that participation of God in the world? I'm inspired by the persistent love of God. Something in my life that reminds me of this persistent love is Chris. Now, all of you who happen to be married have a date that you remember your anniversary when you said yes to the person in your life. Now, Chris tells this story differently. Don't believe it. He says, I pinned him to the ground until he said yes. I did not. Every year, on January 4th, my husband asked me to marry him again. This year, he really surprised me. He came out of the bedroom that morning. We always have coffee together. I'm the one that gets up and starts getting ready early, but I didn't that day. I was sitting on the couch having my second cup of coffee, and Chris walked out in a tuxedo with a bouquet of roses and got down on his knee and asked me to marry him for the 43rd time. Now, that's an image, isn't it?
But I'm telling you, God does that very thing for each of us continually. God gets down where we are and says, I love you more than anything, more than anyone. Will you come with me? Will you come with me? And I think God delights when we say yes. We don't do it perfectly. None of us ever do. Nor did John, James, Andrew, or Simon, or especially Jonah. None of them did it perfectly. They were real people. They responded to God because they were ready to hear something. They were ready. But they were ordinary fishermen. There were women and men who followed Jesus who were ordinary people just like us. They weren't super disciple-like people. We somehow want to make these 12 especially, except Judah, the super disciple-type people. And they weren't. They're just like us. Doing their job, making ends meet, not always looking forward to the next day, but they heard Jesus. Sometimes when we get a call from God, it feels like we treat it like a command, don't you think? You have to follow me. You have to do this. You have to do that. I mean, after all, Jesus said, repent, right? Now, I know Chris told you. I was probably going to try to save every one of you today. He told me he did. Repent. Certainly does have something to do with letting go of sin in our life, asking for forgiveness. But repent has been co-opted. That word has been taken over by people who want to make it into something that it's not. When Jesus said repent, he said, let me give you a new direction in your life. Something that's worth following. Turn around and come with me. That's what repent means. So I think James and John and Simon and Andrew and even Jonah figured it out. Jesus was who he said he was. Jonah heard the God of grace and wanted to be more. They wanted more. They were looking, James, John, Peter, and Andrew, they were looking for a Messiah. They'd been praying and waiting and watching, and they knew him. But you know, heck, maybe they just were ready to leave fishing. Maybe they're tired of fishing. Maybe James and John were looking for a way to get off the boat with their dad. Who knows? But I believe Jesus actually listen to them first. He knew who they were. He got to know them. And then he invited. He not only said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He said, believe in the good news. The invitation that there's something more. The invitation that life is more than you think it is. You can follow that. The truth is God wants more for us. And that's good news, isn't it? We have good news. And everyone needs it. I think James and John and Peter and Andrew were already leaning in and waiting for Jesus. That's what it takes for us sometimes. We got to lean in, wait, and listen. God will speak. God will come. God will meet us where we are. That's the truth. So they jumped at the chance. You ever been at that place before where you were ready? You were ready to let go. You knew you weren't on a good path. You were looking for something else. Something else had to be out there. There had to be another way. You were ready when something came and you jumped. Sometimes when we're listening for God, that happens. I jumped up off that bed at the W and I started making plans. I had no idea where this was leading. Absolutely none. I didn't know I was going to become a part of the Methodist Church. I wasn't even a Methodist at the time. I didn't know I would marry Chris. I didn't know I would become a preacher. I didn't know any of that. But I heard God say, go home. It's not always simple. It's not always easy. Do you think it was easy, James and John, Peter and Andrew, just left everything and walked off? They had family. They had responsibilities. They had a life. Of course there was difficulty. Of course there were changes. But the changes were good. They were good. I think there are times when we're ready to hear and others are ready to hear and God's inviting us to be the ones to share that good news with them. That there's more. There's more to life. God's waiting to give us something else. Men and women believed who Jesus was. And this belief, sometimes we want to make this thing about all about a head knowledge. That we've got to have the right beliefs. No, Jesus is asking us to give our whole life. Like, bet everything you are on this life that he wants you to have and to become like him. You're sold out, totally. You're going to go a different direction, and everything's going to depend on what he teaches you and shows you and opens for you. That's what following Jesus is all about. You're headed one direction, and he gives you a whole new set of priorities in life. That's what the call is about. And it comes constantly. Constantly. If we listen. He wants us to reorient our lives. Jonah had a hard time with this now. When he asked Jonah to go tell Nineveh to repent, Jonah didn't even want to go see those people, much less go preach to them. And sometimes we ask God, are you really calling me to do that? I can't do that. No way. I can't. And Jonah finally did, with a whole lot of encouragement. But the truth is, there's some people we really just have given up on. We don't think they're worth investing in. We don't think they can choose to really follow a holy God. Am I right? There are people we've looked at like that. We've thought about like that. We've been Jonah. We said, don't send me to those. I can't do that. Or they didn't respond how I wanted them to. So why should I keep trying? God doesn't give up on us like that. God is a God of second chances and third and fourth. God continually seeks us and offers us a new way of living. He's inviting us now. Repent. Reorient your life. There is good news in this. There really is good news. I think that if we're all honest with ourselves, we do want that. Even if it means hard choices, difficult days, maybe even sacrifices. We do want that. We want to be with a God who loves us infinitely and has a bigger plan than ours. We come to this place called church. A lot of us come every Sunday. We're invited. You're invited to participate in what God is doing in this place. Individually, you have an invitation to respond to a call. But a community, you, Wells Memorial, has a call to participate in what God is doing. You have been blessed. God has been infinitely gracious to Wells Church. God has continued to use your gifts in this community for loving and caring and sharing the grace of God with all who would receive it. You've been faithful to do that. And He's still wanting you to follow that call. He's given you the resources to do it with. It may be sacrifices that God calls forth in the future for that to continue. But God has made a way and will continue to make a way. You haven't given up on each other or this community. That's a call of God that continues to come. When we walk in a space together with the people of God, we are seeking to become more like Jesus. Isn't that what you're here for today? You really want to become more like Jesus. And that's your call. Never ending seeking and searching. Every aspect of worship has some way of invitation for us that God's grace is available. I think the most visible sign that we have, and you are participants in it every Sunday that you participate in this worship service, is to come to the table. The visible sign of God's grace that it's open to all. The invitation is given. My call came in little pieces. I don't know what I'd have done if God had told me that day on that bed at the W, I'm going to call you to ordained ministry, get ready. I probably would have ran as far as I could in the opposite direction. But God gave me chance after chance to really follow His call. A few years ago, since I've been at Morton, I had a friend there who was one of the most unusual people of the church. And she was a gift to me. God wanted me to get to know this woman more deeply and to walk alongside her. I didn't want to do that. It was going to take too much time. She was too needy. I'm just being honest. She had too many issues and hang-ups. I said, God, I can't invest that much time in this person. And He said, no. You will. This is what I want for you. It wasn't a command, it was an invitation. And finally I said yes. And for 2 years I walked with her in her journey. She was not only a gift to me of God's grace, she was a gift to my mother, who I never, ever would have thought they'd have known each other. And they wound up in the same room in the nursing home in Morton, Mississippi. And I was with them every day, morning and night, together. They were my family, my mother and this woman. You never know what God's going to ask you to do. But if you listen deeply and open yourselves, God will show you how to become a participant in the abundant life that God is offering us. This table is the greatest invitation we can give to remind all people that God came because he loved us. This bread and this cup are symbols of a real presence in this place. And when you leave this place, all these tiny broken pieces, which represent you and Christ, are put back together. And you walk out that door, not as a broken piece, but as a whole piece, united in the love of Christ. Let's give thanks. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, the gift he gave to his disciples on that night in the upper room, and the gift that he continues to give through his Spirit that is now with us always. For the gift of the cross and the invitation of Jesus to come and see and follow is here at this table, in this place, in this moment. We give you thanks for the healing and the unity and the love and grace that we know through this moment of worship. Let us give all that we have to listen for your call on our lives and respond with a mighty yes to the hope of a future that only you know. But we trust you know. In the name of Christ, amen. I want to invite those who will help me serve communion.
Thank you. I shed for you. What a price shed for you. What a price shed for you. What a price shed for you. All this. Thank you for this gift of your mystery, your love. Grant that we may go into the world in your peace and your strength. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. I want to say thank you for enduring me today. And what a joy it's been to be with you. And I hope and pray that together we can follow the call wherever it leads us. Blessings on you. And now will you stand and... Let's sing together. Go in peace.